What's up, everybody? It's your favorite podcast, Get a Bucket. I'm your host, Train, as usual. Hope you're all having a wonderful, wonderful day. As you can see here, I got a special guest, Shaniece Nicole. Shaniece, please tell the folks what's up.
What's up, guys? I'm super excited to be on this podcast, nostalgic, informative, great, great platform, and I'm super excited to unpack.
Excellent, excellent, excellent. Now, Shaniece, I got a question, because you're WNBA center, you know, like, you know, actually, how's your day going? How's your day going? That's rude. That was wrong with me. My bad. I ain't asked how you were doing. How are you? How's everything going?
My day is going well. Like, again, I was hoping for that LA sunshine, but we have a little gloom, and I've been super spoiled being from the Bay Area and now uprooting to LA. And I'm just like, I need sunshine every single day of the week, of the night, in the morning.
Yeah. Rub it in. It's okay. It's cool. It was just raining for me yesterday. It's sunny now though, so it's cool. I can. I'm right here with you. But yesterday was not at all. Now let me ask you this. Just kind of spark off a little nice WNBA conversation. Like I said, you're WNBA center. A friend brought up this interesting question to me, and it low key created like a nice little argument between us. Should the WNBA lower the rim to like under 10 feet?
That's actually a great question. And I've had this conversation multiple of times, and I really think they should. If the concern is higher pay, more entertainment, getting people in the seats and selling more tickets, I think the main thing that draws fans into the NBA is the entertainment. If you're a casual fan, that's why you're watching the NBA. People like us, we are more concerned about the X's and O's. But if you're there for entertainment-wise, it would be beneficial for the WNBA to at least take a look at it. If you have women dunking, and, you know, just doing extra things that the NBA does do, I think it will catapult into another realm for them.
See, so when I first heard it, right, I was like, oh, you can't do that, because they're fighting so hard for equality. So if you lower the rim, like anybody can always say, oh, you're not really equals with men. So I thought that was going to be an issue to selling the actual women fan base, like not the fan. I'm sorry, like the actual athletes. And then I did a little research and I saw Elena Deladon was kind of on board like with that whole ordeal in 2018, if I'm not mistaken. So I understand it from the revenue aspect. I just think that it's possible, like physically, and this is where kind of we got into argument. It's not impossible for like women to do like a windmill dunk. Have we seen it? No, I have not yet. But is it impossible? Like you have to scientifically tell me why it's impossible for that to occur. So for that reason, I understand. Well, I would love to see somebody like catch a body in the WNBA like real casually. Oh my gosh, what? That would be. But I don't know. I think I would be against it. Low key.
But if the fight is for equality, they want to be paid, you know, a little closer to their male counterparts, and they're not being paid just as much as NBA players because they're not selling as many tickets. They don't have the jersey. There's no one in the arenas, so you put people in the arenas, you get people excited, you make more money. The WNBA can make enough money to pay the players more, so
yeah, it could go either way. I would, like I said, I don't think I would be, I don't know if I would like it to lower the rim, but I would also understand it. Like, I would understand it completely because you're bringing in more money to entertainment. Like, now you can have a WNBA slam dunk contest. That would be, and I'm pretty sure that would get some views for at least a couple of years just because it's new. So, and then if it's good, people will continue to watch it. So, I mean, and I think it would be cool.
These women are tall as well. What, 6'1", 6'2", 6'4",
6'7", 6'8". Yep.
As well as Brittany Griner. I mean,
6'7", 6'8". Yep.
Yeah, they can't get up like male athletes, and their hands are much smaller. So I don't think it would be disrespectful for them to lower the rim at least 1 to 2 feet, just based on just genetics alone.
But like the ball is made smaller too, though. Like, it's a different basketball they got to use. I haven't thought about that part because I always figured that you know, they make a ball specifically for like each gender. So like, I would have to give that a little more thought then. I'm back in the day, like how, like when, you know, growing up, you see like a girl up the street, oh, she not nobody, and she come up and bust your tail. Like I look at it from that aspect, like, all right, guys and girls are equals. We can all hoop the same. I understand we get a little more physical traits, like, you know, we might be a little naturally stronger, but I get it. I do get it. I truly do get it. Now, because I got to show people I had on the hat, loving basketball. That's kind of how the conversations started, you know? So my question is this. Is it easier to say what's your favorite movie, or can you give me a top five basketball related?
I can give you one. You know that. No one can ever give one.
I didn't know if you were that tough. I didn't know. I couldn't do it either.
But I can give you five. Now, people may be a bit upset with me with my five because I don't have as many classics as I should. You know what I'm saying? But this is just pure, just for me, something I would watch right now. I would sit down, I'll watch it, identify with it. And it's just one of my favorites. So I'm not going to go in any particular order. I'm just going to throw some things out there. I'm going to start off with that Space Jam, Michael Jordan right there. That is a classic. I honestly just watched it a couple of weeks ago, and I forgot how good it actually is and how great the storyline was and how nostalgic it is. And I'm just at the TV like,
yes,
for Jordan. I'm still captivated by this guy and just that time, that period of time. Number two, loving basketball as you're wearing it on your head right there. I think we all have, you know, fell in love with that movie and so many lines in that movie. Can I be your girl? Like, you want to be my girl? Girls can't ball better than you. Like, we
right.
Know this movie so well. And when she busted his butt, took the hat off, he was like, oh man, he is a girl. Like, you know, it was just a great film and then just a great childhood, you know, movie we all just couldn't connect with. Let me see what else would I have here. Like Mike. I think people forget about Bow Wow. Like, he is our childhood, being millennials, me being 29. Bow Wow was a big part of our childhood. And that film where he's dunking, he had AI up in there, Tracy McGrady.
How do you do that? Like, I love that. All that.
What? And then Morris Chestnut was in there as well. I mean, like, he had the shoes, the pigtails. So that's number three for me. Number four, I'm gonna go above the rim. Soundtrack, the East Coast, Tupac, Dwayne Martin, Marlon Wayans. So many phenomenal, great actors in that film. I think Bernie Mac was in there as well. And I think it's a story that's very familiar to most athletes who are growing up in the inner city communities. It's so relevant. It was relevant then and it's relevant today. So
right.
My last one, I might get some, you know, flack for this, but it's Uncle Drew. It's Uncle Drew. It's Uncle Drew. Listen to me. Listen. why are you doing it like this? Why are you doing it? You didn't like Uncle Drew? Come on.
It was cool. It was cool.
Don't do me like this. Don't do me like this.
All right. So maybe I should give context as to why I was doing that.
Okay.
So I had a couple notable honorable mentions. You had like Juana Mann, okay? The Cookout, Rebound with Martin Lawrence. Semi-pro. I want to say White Men Can't Jump Too. That was a good one. I can throw Above the Rim in for that one as well. My top five in order. I had to put it in order. I had to. Six Man, number five.
Yes, that's a great one. That's a great one.
Coach Carter, number four.
I had Coach Carter.
And then you said my one through three. I had Like Mike as number three, Space Jam as number two, and Love and Basketball as number one. So I had to do those. But you said
Listen, I love when people become characters. And I feel like Kyrie Irving embodied a character we've never seen before. And to me, that's phenomenal. That's great acting, and that he was able to become this entire person as an NBA player.
I'll say this. It was entertaining to watch. I really do think it was entertaining to watch. I would actually watch a sequel. I really would. Kyrie did do a phenomenal job. Well, he did a good job. Phenomenal is like, that's a different stratosphere. Like he did a good job. Like your first film, for real, like that was, it was good. So I think he has like a decent eye for like the talent and like direction. So I think he could possibly link up with Spike, clean up a few things. I'm not mad at it at all. But I was just mad, not mad really. Top five though, that's tough. That's not slack worthy though. I don't know. You might get some slack for that actually. I'm not going to throw it your way. I'm just saying you might. You could, I understand.
This comes out and they hear that Uncle Drew. It's over with. It's.
I mean, you at least got one person backing you, Kyrie. So, you know, you.
Is that a good thing? Is that a?
Yeah, we're in the sports world. He's backing you. I think that's okay. Like, I would take that. I'd be okay.
Well,
like, matter of fact, Uncle Drew is my third top tier. Yeah. Just in case, Kyrie. Just in case. But nah. A little sports discussion here. A little sports discussion, right? Who's your favorite WNBA and NBA player and team?
Ooh, you know what? If I can answer this honestly, when Kobe retired, I was struggling to find a player to connect with. When Kobe retired, I actually fell out of love with basketball just a little bit. Because I've never been big on LeBron, although I think he's great. He's top five. But I've never been a big LeBron fan. And shout out to LeBron. He's doing amazing things off the court. I think he's a great family man, great pillar. But if I had to go with somebody, it would probably have to be Damian Lillard.
Same time,
baby.
Okay.
He's from the Bay like I am, and he's consistently gotten better since he's entered the league out of Weber State. Rookie of the year, participated in, I believe, three events, you know, his first year during All-Star Weekend, has put Portland on his back, has been committed to Portland, has stayed loyal to Portland, and has uplifted that franchise and community. He goes out every single night and perform. I mean, CJ McCollum hasn't been there for half of the season. He's there now, of course. But without a CJ McCollum, they're still, you know, in that playoff hunt, in the playoffs as we speak. So I think if you have a guy like Dame, you have a great piece, not even a great piece, but just a superstar player you can, you know, build your team around.
Okay. How about on the WNBA side?
WNBA side, who would I go with? You know what? I'm going to go with Candace Parker.
Good answer.
I was surprised when she, you know, decided to go back to her hometown Chicago. But her career is similar to an NBA player's career as far as longevity. She's been in the league for a long time.
13 seasons.
You don't typically see that in the WNBA, and she's remained elite.
Well, yeah.
That's nothing to blink at. I believe that the typical WNBA career maybe 6-7 years at the prime level. She's been consistently a badass. Consistently. And she puts her team, you know, in the position to win a WNBA championship every single year.
And
it creates that buzz around the WNBA. Like, everyone's talking about the Chicago Sky because she's there. So all the way is the girl, Candace Parker.
Okay. And I like the fact that both of your players have, like, a consistent theme. I think while we look at Damian Lillard and Candace Parker as elite caliber players, I don't think they get enough real credit. Like, if you throw Dame on that Warriors team instead of Steph, they arguably do very similar, if not better, because I think Dame's a little bit better defender. And then Candace Parker, she gets, like, she don't get enough credit for what she does, bro. Like, she was the defensive player of the year, but didn't get to the all-defense team. Like, how does that happen? Like, how does something like that happen? It's absurd. So, the fact I like both players that you pick. Is it fair to say you are a Sparks and Lakers fan, or are you a Blazers fan by chance?
Oh, it's fair to say that I'm a Lakers and Sparks fan. But now, again, you know, I'm just looking for a player to connect with. And
right,
I'm watching basketball, it's either Dame that's catching my attention or Stephen Curry. It's like one out of the other.
Kyrie getting any love?
I think Kyrie's great, but he's not someone.
Not that, on that level.
Yeah. It's not that he's not on that level. If we're just talking about favorite players, I prefer Damian Lillard's playing style over Kyrie's.
Okay. That's respectable. I get that. Okay. Now, you made an interesting statement the other day.
What did I say?
90s WNBA. You said was what again compared to this year's? This generation's?
It's more nostalgic, or?
I don't think nostalgic was the word. You said what?
I said it was.
What'd you say?
More popular.
Yeah. How is it more popular? I'm curious.
Well, I believe 90s was a popular time anyway. And I think the league was created in 97.
Mm-hmm. 97.
Yeah, I think when anything is new, brand new, it's exciting. Anyway. But I think what the 90s WNBA did was connect to the culture.
Mm-hmm.
We had the 97 Olympics team on the Martin show. You remember that episode?
I do.
Exactly. Bus Martin, but Cheryl Swoops had her own signature shoe.
To be fair, though, they never won that game officially. It's still undetermined. So a comeback is possible. Martin,
yes.
I'm up.
Yes. Listen, Cheryl Swoops had her own shoe. Tina Thompson had her own signature lips. No one forgets the red lips. And I think it was just so much that was connected to that time, connected to the culture that's missing today. And I honestly believe that the WNBA needs a new love language. I think right now it's affirmation, everyone speaking life into the WNBA. But I also believe that it needs to be more of a physical touch and spending time. In the 90s, we saw NBA players actually spend time with WNBA players. How dope would it be when Candace Parker was here to have her in a gym with Anthony Davis and LeBron James? How dope would that be? Just representation in general.
They have a couple of NBA and WNBA moments, though. Like, I think that the league was doing a little bit better job of that, especially when, like, Kobe retired and showed that it was showing a little bit more investment. We had a nice little impact with Kobe and Lisa because they grew up together.
Yes.
But, like, yeah, it would have been nice to see, like, Candace and maybe Kobe have a little picture or something like that. Like, show, you know, like, getting a little more popularity with the WNBA. It would have been nice to see that earlier on. I do admit that part. Like, yeah.
Even with the NBA All-Star Weekend, I think they completely cut this out, but during the skills competition, they used to have an NBA player, a WNBA player, and a legend from the same team. They don't do that anymore, so there's no representation, the opportunity to build that relationship as well. And I believe Nike in the 90s were more committed to making better commercials with the women during that time. There's so many nostalgic commercials for WNBA players in the 90s. Now, I get it. We're heading in a different direction. Everything is social media based. We're living in a virtual realm here. empowerment, community, so many different things we have to tackle as women and as a community. But I think we definitely should get back to just being fun sometime and being relatable and connecting and spending time with one another.
I thought the WNBA like women were more popular now, maybe compared to back then, just because of the social media era alone. Like when you have access to people internationally now, like that's huge. So like, for example, Sabrina Ionescu, you might not have really watched college basketball, but you hear, oh, Russell Westbrook's getting triple doubles, and now Sabrina Ionescu is the triple double queen. Oh wow, let's watch her. Like Candace Parker, solid. Stewie comes back off of ACL, gets you a nice championship. Sue Bird, being compared to LeBron James in terms of longevity, like you see like all these different WNBA stars, and like I just see like the impact that they're having. I don't know about how much of an impact within their individual communities, but it seems like women are at least realizing, hey, these women are doing X, Y, Z, this, that, and the third. And I thought it was becoming more popular based on that. Not to mention, they get more money in their pocket too this year. So hopefully that goes up a little bit as well. But I will say this, the X's and O's, because I understand it more now, I think I like this era better. But I think from the fanboy fandom statement, the 90s might have to be the wave, because that's when I really fell in love with it. Like Lisa Leslie, Kobe, like those were true staples. So I do understand where you're coming from in that. Like I truly do. If there was one era you could enjoy really watching and like going to like one game, what would it be to like revisit and watch live?
Ooh, that's honestly a great question. I think it would be maybe the 2000s. That's when Shaq was dominant. He and Kobe were winning championships. Tim Duncan was in his prime.
Yep.
We had Vince Carter was jumping out the stadium. Like Jason Richardson was dunking out the stadium. Tracy McGrady. I think I would definitely have enjoyed that era of basketball.
Okay. That's fair. Now, final question, and then we're going to discuss all about you. Mm-hmm. WNBA or NBA? Which one would you rather live with?
Like, what do you mean live with?
Like, if you had to get rid of one. Not saying we want to, but like, you like, which one do you prefer more? Like, which one is your favorite?
Oh, NBA all day.
Okay. I didn't know if you were a little bit of WNBA head like that. I got a friend who's actually more of a WNBA fan than an NBA fan. It caught me off guard. I thought I might find another one, but it's cool. No issue.
Definitely.
So, you said, what was that?
Definitely NBA, definitely.
Respect. So, Shaniece, Nicole, who is that? Again, for the people who don't know, who is that? Not just like not in sports media. I mean, like just in general. Who are you? Like tell us a little bit about yourself.
That's a great question. That's honestly a great question. First, a disciple. I put faith at the forefront of every single thing I do, and what you have to being African American woman. You know, it's so just saturated. And here in LA, you have to have like keep your integrity first, keep your mind right, allow God to, you know, guide your steps so you can make the right decisions. Mm-hmm. So that's number one. I'm also, you know, what else? I'm a daughter. I'm a family woman as well. I'm a student.
Okay.
I really enjoyed my time in college. And it was just a great time to soak it in, to download, to learn, to have an impact, to be impacted, just to be fed so much knowledge. And I've grown so much from my educators, so much from my institution. that made me feel so empowered to just go out into the world and feel like I can do anything that I wanted to do. Ooh, I'm also a seeker. I'm a seeker. I love it. I love to go out and just find new things. And I've been like that since I've been a child. A dreamer. Dreamer. Mm-hmm. I think Black girls are allowed to dream. And I do thank my parents for, you know, giving me the space to feel like I can just accomplish anything I want to accomplish without worrying about my gender or my race or anything of that nature. All those things are prevalent now as an adult, and I have learned how to navigate that. But as a child, I was just had my blinders on, and I just was thinking I could be anything, accomplish anything I want to accomplish, and I still live by that.
Okay. All right. That's some good stuff, though. That's all good stuff. Dang. I mean, but look, it makes sense, though. It makes sense because, like, full disclosure, people, you know, Shanice actually, you know, she's no slouch at this thing. You know, like, you're pretty solid out there. I saw a couple of interviews you did. Like, tell me a little bit about that. Like, how did you get the NBA athletes to your space? Because, again, like, with me, I've had an NBA or WNBA athlete maybe follow or like my picture or something like that. But to get that connection, to me, that says, okay, you had the hustle, you had the grind, the dedication, the hard work. Like you said, you're a seeker. So that, like, everything you're saying, it kind of lines up with everything that I'm seeing. So, like, give me a little bit of backstory about like the interview that you were able to pull up. You know, you don't have to say anything too specific, just like a little bit of detail, if you don't mind.
You know what? As I was trying to figure out maybe four years ago how to insert myself into this NBA realm and a sports realm, with it being very just competitive out here, you know, a million people are applying to ESPN. A million people, right? I couldn't.
Everybody named Mama.
And I couldn't get an internship during college. And those things happen. People are going to tell you no. They're going to tell you no. And that doesn't mean quit. That doesn't mean you walk away. That doesn't mean you demean yourself. You keep pushing. And so maybe it's about 4 years ago, the All-Star Weekend was in Los Angeles. And this one I was living in the Bay Area, San Francisco area. And I was talking to my mom. I'm like, I really want to go to this. I'm going to navigate this. I'm going to work this event. But that, I didn't have any credentials at the time. And so I went on social media and I typed in hashtag All-Star Weekend, and so many people popped up. And this woman, her name is Alicia. She's a producer, and she put something on her story. She said, hey, have an event, a charity event for my homeboy, Jamie Foxx, right?
Okay.
And maybe she had 2,000 followers at the time. And I connected. I sent her a DM. I was like, hey, you know what? I'm Shaniece Nicole. I'm really interested in covering the event. I'm a college student, you know, just breaking down who I am.
Right.
Show myself in this message, which is relatively challenging, you know. But I gave her my number. No lie. 2 days later, she calls me. Actually, she called me twice. I didn't know who it was. I said hello. She was like, girl, she's like, I'm glad you answered this phone. I'm going to go call again. And I was like, he was like, I'm about to make your dreams come true. This is Alicia. And she was like, I want you to come out to LA to Jamie Foxx's house in Thousand Oaks to work this charity event. Crazy, right? And so she said, I'm partnering up with Ryan. Ryan is one of Drake's guys. And so he's the event manager of the entire thing. And so I head to LA. My very first interview, Dez Bryant. My second, Johnny Manziel. My third, Wale.
Ooh, DC chilling.
Hey. Yes. Oh,
those are bangers. That's tough. Like,
yeah. Dang.
I know you were excited.
Super, super excited. Kind of just, you know, but I felt like I belonged. And so I wasn't nervous.
Right.
I felt like I belonged and wasn't nervous. And then from that point forward, I stayed in LA for the rest of the weekend. I end up connecting with this guy named Jude. He has a women's basketball league out here called Basketball Beauties. That's really, really popular. And he had an event during All-Star Weekend. And there I had the opportunity to interview Aaron Gordon.
Okay, AG.
Okay, and so building that portfolio, I said, okay, I have some work. I can shop this work. I have content backing me up. And so next step, I need to get credentialed so I can be in these spaces officially. And so I finally had an internship with a news company in the Bay Area, Black-owned called Post News Group. Mm-hmm. And I insisted that he credentialed me. I insisted. So when I was done with him, I'm able to still navigate these spaces.
Right.
So him, he credentialed me. And I was able from that point forward to work with the MLB. And that was super fun for me. I covered the A's, I covered the Giants. And from that point forward, I just started building that portfolio.
Okay. And,
you know, it's just been, you know, good from there.
Tough. So sounds like you've had a lot of success. Tell me something then. What were some of your pitfalls throughout the journey? Like, what were some things maybe that you personally went through? Like, I know, for example, like, I don't know, with editing videos, right? That's a tedious task. And sometimes I was like, you know what? I don't like doing this mess no more. And it's like, turn the screen. Snow falls on. Like, you know, like, I'd rather just do something like that. And then I got to turn it back around and get back. And like, what are some like pitfalls that you went through throughout your 4-year journey that like you wouldn't mind sharing with some folks?
Oh my God. There was so many. And I'm trying to give you a good one on top of my head here. For me, it was knowing once I got in that space of the MLB, it was knowing how to navigate it like an official reporter. I was there, I was walking around, but who was I supposed to be talking to, right?
Networking, got you.
Was it the coaches? Was it the owner? And it was just this thing where I had to prep. Now, prepping is something that I absolutely needed to grow. Like, the sport, you know, we know the sport, but professionally, there's so much preparation that goes into the craft that you have to be ready for when you're entering these arenas because you are dealing with professional athletes.
Right.
So for me, it was preparation. But it was also dealing with peers' perception of who I am.
And okay.
And questioning my sincerity and my motives in this space. And I think women, specifically Black women, have it most challenging because it's if you are the slightest bit of attractive or, you know, Black women, we have bodies, we're curvaceous, and sometimes we are often over-sexualized. I think it gives off this vibe that we are there with, you know, these not so great intentions. Well, I'm here because you're here. I went to college for this. I love basketball. I love these players. I want the story. But it's also, I ran into, it's people don't believe that, you know. And I had this issue with my editor, with him just, I was super surprised, who was African-American and just throwing off these microaggressions. Like, hey, make sure you conduct yourself right in the locker room. Would you tell a man that? You know what I mean? I need to make sure you know how to conduct yourself. Well, I'm a professional. I have integrity. Right. You had conversations with me. You hired me. So why don't you trust me enough to be around these players? And I think it's something for young girls to consider and to know that you can't put yourself in a position to compromise your integrity. I don't care how cute the player is or what he's saying to you, if he's in your DM. You know, if it's a true connection, then okay, whatever you wanna do. But please, just follow your passion and walk with integrity, because once you love, that could be detrimental. It's, yeah, it's bad.
Yeah, no, that, it's weird that you say that, like, because I understand from his, so I understand from your supervisor's, like vantage point, okay, well, look, I don't want you to do anything that's damning to your career or mine. But on the flip side, like you said, well, if the company did their due diligence, it shouldn't be anything more than a, hey, everyone, like, be mindful of not doing X, Y, Z, this, that, and third, blase, blase, not, hey, Shanice, real quick, love what you've done, but you can't sit up there and, like, you know, like, I don't need all, have you been doing this? Like, is this something that's consistency from you? Because if not, you don't need to harp on anything. Everyone, if that's good, everyone gets the same treatment. So like you said, that is tough. That is tough.
It's tough. It's so tough. And, you know, it's like, you know, we judge people, you know, based off their exterior, right? Mm-hmm. Based off race, ethnicity, and gender. But we truly don't know who each other are. We don't know each other internally. And so for me experiencing that, I'm telling my father, like, damn, dude, what is this? What's going on with people? And so it took me a while to actually understand why that it would be perceived that way and be much more mature to dismantle it versus just going home and being super emotional about it, because I can't afford to do that. I just need to prove them wrong.
Yep. It sucks that, like, that's really all you can do is just prove them wrong. It's like, that part right there is frustrating because you see someone else and they have other options, but, like, we don't really have those. So, and then also from, like, something you said as well, it is interesting how, like, when you bring, like, a, like, woman sports analyst onto the show, like, not this one, but just anyone, I think people don't, like, overlook what you guys actually do. I know, like, some of my friends and I, like, not I, like, it's like just, we've said, like, oh, well, you know, like Malika Andrews or Taylor, like, oh, well, they're attractive, this, that, and those are just, like, the highlights for people who they, like, try to show throughout. But, like, there are other women out there too who just, like, who are speaking, and you're realizing, or at least I'm realizing, wow, we're all talking about how attractive they are and not necessarily about what they're saying as much. And it's like, you, again, I'm saying this about myself, like, this is things that I'm noticing. So it's like, I do hate that about women, to, like, that's how they're looked at. Like, one person even said, oh, ESPN knows what they're doing, but they brought in Malika.
Yeah.
And it's like, that's tough, bro, because what if she just really good at her job? Like, what if she just knows how to prepare really well? It's just, I hate that vantage point for you guys. So, like, what are some things you... How can we combat that best in your eyes?
Ooh, Lord, that's honestly.
I know it's a lot, but, like, you know, I just wanted to give a platform real quick.
That's a great way to combat what, sexism, patriarchy.
Maybe we should move on. That's a lot.
But don't get me started. No. You know, that's a great question. And I think it's a conversation that needs to start happening with men. ESPN reporters or NBA players should hold a panel. You know, hold a panel unpacking, you know, these issues. And I think it starts with them, because women can protest and we can speak about it all day long. But the real change is going to start with you guys and our leaders that are in the industry. Let's say if, you know, Stephen A. Smith did a segment on his show about, you know, about the topic, that would be super dope. He doesn't have to be, you know, fake or, you know, just over the top. He can be himself and just discuss it. I think that conversation alone would just go a really, really long way, because, you know, ESPN First Take, Molly doesn't talk much. But Molly knows football. Molly knows football. I know someone who was really great friends with Molly, and she works for the Oakland Raiders. Well, Molly knows her football, but we don't know Molly knows her football because she doesn't get the opportunity to unpack football like Max Kellerman and Stephen A. Smith.
You can tell, though, she likes it more than basketball because every time they talk about the Giants and whatnot, she's in it. She's more engaged as opposed to like the NBA. It's more trying to moderate. I can tell the difference a little bit about that. That makes sense.
She's ready. It'd be dope if they can just give her maybe a two-minute, just a hot topic. Just give her a moment in the game for a while. She started off at the NFL Network, then transitioned to ESPN. But no, I would love to hear, you know, Molly talk more about sports. I mean, that's a step as well. You know,
they got First Take. It's like First Take. It's Shanice running it, if I'm not mistaken. Like Shanice on it, isn't she? I'd have to look at the exact name, but I know, like, I think there's like an all-girl version of First Take or something like that that they're trying to have come on, if I'm not mistaken. Well, I thought that was, at least. I could be wrong, but the point of that was just to say that I do think that they are at least trying to bring on more women analysts and showcase them a little bit more. So, like, I at least appreciate that. I think there was like a solid week where like ESPN, where First Take just had like different women analysts on consistently. So I mean, I at least do appreciate that. And I can say at least it is trending upwards for you guys. Like,
oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So as long as things are progressing at a respectable rate, that, you know, that's all I can really ask for. But at the same time, if that's something y'all want to ask for more, I can't like overshadow that too. I'm not necessarily going through it. I'm on y'all's side, but I kind of defer to what y'all say in a few instances. So, but hopefully there is something that can be done. But you know, is there anything specific that you've gone through? Like, it doesn't have to be anything like right now, just in life, from a either racial or a gender perspective that you dealt with that you want to like share and kind of tell your story about?
That's a great question as well. You know what, to be honest, I haven't experienced anything too racial.
Okay.
Not directly at all. Again, you know, I told you about the experience with my editor. I was close to news group, and that was purely gender related. And I'm still climbing the ladder, just as you are. And right. So when preparing myself, if that were to happen, I assume, which is probably awful to say, I assume as I grow my career, I will probably experience more.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, I really like the route that Jemele Hill is taking right now, her and Carrie Champion. They're creating their own content. And that's honestly the same wave I'm on, because when you're within a company, you are basically following their blueprint, their identity. But with them, they're creating their own wave. They left ESPN.
Yep.
I'm done with that. And building their own platform. And they're getting more notoriety, more buzz, you know. Guys are always tapping in with Carrie Champion and Jemele Hill. People actually listen to Jemele Hill. Like, yeah.
I'm about to throw a picture of Jemele Hill on my page at some point, because I met her at Made in America. So like, at some point in time, I was gonna make that a post, dog. Like, everybody liked Jemele. I've always been a fan of Carrie Champion. Carrie was always cool, especially when I found out she was a Lakers fan. Like, oh, respectful. Like, and then when they left, I hated how Jemele got treated. And then Carrie, I haven't really heard anything too negative about Carrie, to be honest with you. Like, she just seems like she's chilling, minding her business, stacking her paper, working hard. So I those are two women who I definitely would love to just like give a shout out to and just pick their brains at some point in time. Cause like you said, they're hard workers and it seems like they're going the non-conventional route. So I mean, those are definite stars to have in this sports world. Would you say that would be like a ultimate dream for you to be similar to them, or is it something different?
Definitely, because I value autonomy and I believe athletes do as well. And to be fair, athletes don't like reporters. They don't like reporters. And so I never say, hey, I'm Shaniece Nicole, a reporter for so-and-so. Mm-hmm. Like, if I'm connecting with an athlete, I'm finding a different angle. And to be honest, I would not approach an athlete unless I had a genuine interest of who he actually is.
Right.
For the crowd, I reach out to people for the story. I love your story. Let's chat, let's talk, let's unpack. Let me get to know you. And so that's how I always approach players. Like, a guy, like, one of my dream interviews is Russell Westbrook. Freaking love Russell Westbrook. Like, people don't even talk about how this man was a 4.0 student in high school. Could have went to any college he wanted to go to. With or without basketball, Westbrook was destined for greatness. Right? Right. His sweetheart, following the footsteps of his parents, being a strong Black male. But those are the things that we don't talk about outside of him messing up an NBA game. And I think white reporters, you know, that's all they're going to focus on. But I'm pretty much focused on pushing the basketball and pushing the culture forward. So
No, that's dope. That's dope. I was actually going to ask you who would be a dream interview for you, and I'm glad you asked. Glad you answered that one. Because, like, that
one, though. I have two. He's just a one.
No, I was saying, because, like, you brought up a great point. Like, bro, we talk about, like, I bashed LeBron James. I'm not going to say better than most, but I'm in that class. Like, you're like, all right, cool. I talk about LeBron from time to time. And I'm a little skeptical. I'm a little critical. You know what I'm saying? But, like, I don't talk about what he does off the court too much, because that, like, we're only focusing on what he does on the court. But I think people have to remember, like, I at least remember, recognize, acknowledge, okay, well, he does this, that, and the third, blase, blase, blase. So every time when I'm talking about him to somebody else, I always kind of put in the context, well, as a basketball player, I don't say just Braun, like, unless the conversation is strictly basketball. It's like, well, as a basketball player, he's blah, 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 blah. As a person, he's cool. Like, seems like he's doing things on the up and up. Like, you haven't heard anything about any scandals or anything like that. Like, I think the worst I've ever heard was one athlete told me he does steroids. And I'm like, I get why you say it, because the boy looked brolic as all get out. 6'8", 250, running like a guard. Like, I understand it. He tried to make the same statement about Dwight Howard. They're just freaking nature athletes. I don't know what to tell you, champ. Like, anybody would make that same statement. That's the worst I've heard about LeBron James as a person. So it's like, that's he say, she say. We have to at least recognize these people as good people in the world. And you're absolutely right. We don't give enough credit to them.
It's okay to critique. That's why we're here to critique.
Right.
But I feel like people cross the line so much. It's so confusing. The lines are blurred. When they start critiquing and it becomes bashing, and they're taking sound bites and they're you know, reporting fake news or news that's not accurate. And reporters, we have to, you know, just be grounded in our integrity. Did the player say this? Stick to the statistics. You can critique a player, but you can't bash this player. And I think that's why athletes have a problem with members of the media.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah. It's real easy to twist words. Like, it's so easy to twist words, bro. Like, just, like, imagine if LeBron James comes back, right? And from injury, right? Like, and then he's ready to play, but he, I guess, just plays maybe 5-10 minutes. Media could easily switch that to, or try to switch that to, is LeBron James trying to, I don't know, is he too old or whatever the case may be? Nah, dog, he just came back off injury. Like, media always tried to spin the story to whatever is clickbait, like, whatever is clickable best. So, I mean, I wish we could get more honest news, because honestly, that helps us out so much more. Like, oh, we can have a legitimate discussion about where we think this person's going to go or that person's going to go or what's happening with this player or this team. I would love it, but everybody just wants to spin the news to draw that attention. And it's like, just be genuine, be yourself. That's what I was telling you earlier. Like you said, you want that story, you want that genuineness, that realness to actually come out. So that's, I really wish everyone focused on that, but in today's age, it's you gotta get that clickbait.
Challenging. We are in this social media influencer era, which isn't bad. It's not bad at all. Lies off of social media. It's crazy. A lot of, you know, basketball influencers are, that's the new wave now. They're making YouTube videos.
TikToks.
Like, I think, you know, it's a great way for us to see our athletes in a different light, but we just want to be careful with
it. Yeah. It's a fine balance. It is a fine balance. Now, let me ask you this, because, you know, we're around the same age in terms of this whole sports media thing, but, like, you got me by a couple of years. So, you know, you kind of like an elder statesman in this current moment. Do you have any advice to the young guns, the young bucks, if you will, whether it's pros, cons, do's, don'ts, anything?
Post your content. I don't care how bad you think it is. Post your content. It's gonna get better. Mm-hmm. You have to stay consistent. Even with me, I'm like, well, that's not good. I'm not gonna post it. But you have to post. You have to let people know that you're out here, that you're working, and that you're trying to get better. Companies will take a chance on you.
Mm-hmm.
What else? Again, I use the word integrity a lot. Always walk with that. Please stick to the story. Don't add any details that are not true. Make sure that you're making the person you're interviewing feel as comfortable as possible. One mistake in this industry is super small. It can ruin your career, you know, forever. Also, be a person of your word. Be a person of your word. People reach out all the time, like, oh, I'm gonna interview you. Okay, let's set it up. You know, send the link, and then they don't. You know, you wanna be consistent. You wanna say, hey, you want people to say, like, hey, she is a woman of her word, and she's gonna follow up. If you have a deadline, you told someone you're going to have this ready by Wednesday, have it ready by Wednesday. But yeah, and also don't be afraid to take your own route. There's so many ways to get there. And I think with your platform, people would love to come on your platform. You can get paid for what you do, and you're comfortable in your own home. You don't have to be on ESPN. You don't have to be on Fox. Athletes are looking for authentic platforms. As long as you're authentic, it will come to you.
Right. Yeah. No, that's actually synonymous with what, I'm not going to name drop on this one, but like one person, they do have a check mark on their name. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. But no, like, she told me to keep my same energy, keep that same vibe going. So if I want to be the nice, peaceful, positive, motivational page, okay, well, do that. Like, whatever you're doing, just be consistent with it. And ever since then, I've been trying to just make sure I find what I want to do and then be consistent with that. So it sounds like you're saying similar thing, just be consistent with it. And that post your content part is good, is also great advice as well, because one of my friends is in the YouTube space, and I was asking him, like, I had a video that I posted that, like, it wasn't gonna be monetized. And I'm like, should I try to take that part out, edit some things? He was like, nah, just post your content. That's all. Like the main thing is just getting those hours up there so people can see it. And like you said, it can possibly work, but you only need one person to view you. So it's just tough though, bro. It's so much work. It's like, dang, I just need one pair of eyes. But I have so much content. Are you on your computer?
Yes.
I got you.
I put my phone on do not disturb, and you know my iPhone is connected to my laptop, so it's just like receiving phone calls and emails.
Yeah, but, no, it's cool. I was gonna say I actually had I only had one more question for you. So I stole this from All the Smoke. Who is one person you would not mind bringing or inviting onto the show? And it has to be someone you have to be able to connect me with too.
Okay. Yeah.
We can't say like LeBron James and like, oh yeah, LeBron, you should get him. Like, you got to be able to connect to him. So do you have anybody in mind, and that could be athlete, coach, anybody that's, again, affiliated with sports who has a good story and wouldn't mind coming on the show and just talking?
Yeah, actually, Joe Smo Training, he's a trainer out here in Los Angeles, as well as a high school coach. And he's actually Kenny Smith's nephew, and he played college ball. And he was just training CJ McCollum this off season. You know what, when I met Joe, he was just hella authentic. Nice guy, just willing to talk, like just full of fun. And I think he'd love to sit down and have a conversation with you.
Okay, I bet. I know we're gonna have a few things to talk about that, because you know we got the Duke over here. So I'll make sure I wear my Duke jersey or shirt or something at least for the interview there. That'll be a good one. That'll be a good one. But no, Shaniece, Nicole, I appreciate it. Is there anything else that you want to say to the folk before we head out?
I had a great time. It was lit. We turned up, we talked basketball. You're fitted for the occasion, the Hey Arnold. That's Penny, that's everybody on there.
Oh, that's everybody.
Yes, I love it. Love a basketball hat. And I just want to encourage you to keep doing what you're doing. Like, again, when I caught wind of your platform, I immediately was like, yo, this is super cool. It's super dope. I want to be a part of this. And I'm pretty sure other people will feel the same way. And they do feel the same way.
Well, I greatly appreciate that. That actually means a lot. Because like I said, you've been doing this for a while. So the fact that you actually noticed it means a lot. I greatly appreciate it. And like, I'm trying to get like you, Sebi, all y'all, like all you guys have like a lot of actual professional stuff done. Like realistically, you have a good team in place, it seems like. So, I mean, I'm like I said, I'm just trying to get to y'all level at some point in time. So the fact that you were able to come on the show, I greatly do appreciate it.
And lastly, I learned this from Issa Rae in her interviews, and she always tells us to network across.
Mm-hmm.
Network across. Most times people are trying to get these big time athletes and these big time people, but it's honestly your peers that are ascending. You have to catch talent while it's boiling.
Yep.
And I saw that in you. It's like 2-3 years from now, you're going to be big. And people are going to be like, oh, I should have messed with him. No, yeah, you really should have. So please just continue to network across. And that's how Sebi and I connected, just networking across.
Definitely. I was always told it's not what you know, it's who you know. I'm not saying I'm slow or dumb, but I don't think I'm the smartest person in the room every time. So I have to know somebody who at least is, or someone who can help out to kind of compensate for things I'm lacking. So I always definitely want to make sure I network properly. So like I said, I'm glad you reached out, and you're pretty emphatic about it too. I was like, oh, she really likes WNBA. We got a fan. Yes. And she's like, I want to be on the show. Even better. So yeah, definitely. And I greatly do appreciate it. And I would love for you to come on the show again. So please don't think this is the only time. You're more than welcome anytime. Just let me know. We get it situated. Definitely.
Let me know if you're ever in LA. You know.
Oh, definitely. I'll definitely hit you up. Well, everybody, with all that being said, that's all the time we have. Thank you all for listening. Shaniece, I really do appreciate it once again. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, hope you all have a good one. Take care.
Take care, guys.
Oh, I did not know you guys were still here. As you can see, we're at the back end of the show. No pun intended, but look, hope you all enjoyed it. And before you go, please subscribe to the YouTube channel, follow the IG account, share the content to anybody who's anybody. And most importantly, leave your thoughts and comments below. But I gotta go back and play Buddy in 2K, so let me unmute him real quick. Excuse me. Hey, boss, I'm back. Nah, you better catch this word. You know we get buckets around here, kid.